Hello everyone and welcome, and today we look at some more Georgian buildings in Leeds. Last time we ended at the junction of Lower Briggate with Bourne Lane, which had yet to be widened, and we were heading west. Today I want to talk you through the development of what was quite literally all fields up to the 1750s and 60s, roughly the area of modern day City Square and Park Row, back towards Park Square and glancing up Wellington Street towards the site of the recently demolished Yorkshire Post building. From nothing, by the 1820s this area had become arguably an alternative focal point for the town, at least for the mercantile and professional classes, a mix of residential housing for the well-off and some important secular buildings. So prior to the second half of the 18th century, apart from Mill Hill Chapel, pictured, and a dye house up at Droney Lathe at what is now the end of Wellington Street, this area was merely fields and farm roads, the remains of a medieval park which had been broken up into small closes. By the 1700s, this land belonged to the Wilson family, who resided at the manor house on Mill Hill, where the Scarborough Taps now stands. Development started when, in the mid-1750s, Richard Wilson, a lawyer and recorder, released an isolated plot of land for building a mixed or coloured cloth hall opened on what is now the site of City Square and the old post office in 1758. It was his son, also called Richard Wilson, who commenced an ambitious building project on the rest of the estate, laying out houses on Park Row and the two parades, east and south, and this scheme was advanced by the addition of Park Square, Park Place and so on. While this was purely residential in its beginnings, it was tempered by the presence of important new public buildings, which we'll talk about in turn, meaning that by the end of the Georgian era, it had led to what Maurice Beresford terms a new West End. So let's first look at the mixed or coloured cloth hall. It was designed by John Moxon, surveyor of highways at Leeds, and built of red brick between 1756 and 1757, with the addition of a rotunda or exchange in 1780. Now, there had been provision for the sale of undyed or white cloth in a covered cloth hall since 1711 on Kirkstall. But the opening of this new building, financed by the clothiers themselves, meant that by 1758 those selling dyed or coloured cloth had somewhere to meet undercover too. Though single storey, its buildings were capable of holding 1,770 stalls on market days for sale of both white and coloured cloth in its two enormous wings, which were lit by 199 windows. Not only that, its courtyard could hold public meetings and events, and this could accommodate 20,000 people. These steps were known for good reason as the Parliamentary Steps, and in its last days in the 1880s, the Cloth Hall hosted a rally for the newly elected Leeds MP Herbert Gladstone, giving us a flavour of what a good crowd looked like. It's harder to gauge the colour of the building from black and white photos, but this painting of Reverend Hook, Vicar of Leeds, inspecting cloth there, gives you a glimpse through those windows to the red brick and courtyard beyond. One needed a ticket to enter the cloth hall, like this one here, and also surviving in the museum collections are a bell from the hall, and this coin depicting the hall. Another addition to this end of Leeds came in 1771 with the opening of a new infirmary, to which Infirmary Street owes its name, and this was situated directly behind the mixed cloth hall. The lack of medical provision for Leeds inhabitants led merchants and doctors to initiate the project, which was funded entirely by public subscription. After temporary accommodation in Andrew Wilson's house off Kirkstall, the General Infirmary of Leeds opened at a cost of £4,599, designed by John Carr, on land behind the coloured cloth hall. There were 27 beds initially. By 1792 this had expanded to 108 beds, with a third floor having been added in the 1780s. In 1788, John Howard, the prison reformer, described the infirmary as one of the best in the kingdom. There is great attention to cleanliness and no bugs in the beds. In time it outgrew its site and moved to its current location, but as you can see from photos, it boasted extensive gardens which stretched over the site of what is now the Hotel Metropole. Now, these buildings were one-off schemes, but from 1767 there commenced a conscious residential building project. At this time, no new street had been built in Leeds since 1613, and the overcrowded medieval town centre was losing its appeal to those who might be able to afford to live elsewhere. It was in 1767 that the building of the first street commenced, and its name was Park Row. Houses were built on the east side only, and with the addition of South Parade to the north, East Parade to the west shortly after, the intention, and initially the effect, was to have the new houses fronting onto a huge open square. The project was hugely influenced by examples in other towns and cities, notably Bath, London and Bristol, and it marked a step towards segregation by income. It was a gamble that, in the short term, paid off, as interest from the professional classes and merchants was enough to see it through to completion. Other streets soon followed, and although interrupted by the American and Napoleonic Wars, by the early 19th century these streets had been joined by Park Place and Park Square, with its estate church of St Paul's, built by Thomas Johnson in 1794, and virtually used as a private chapel by the estate's residents. In the ever-changing townscape of the Industrial Revolution, it is unsurprising that this genteel picture should not last long, and while residents of Park Square had the forethought to purchase their square to save it from becoming a building site in 1806, the same didn't happen with the land between Park Row and East Parade. The successors of Richard Wilson, who had observed the estate growing from the close proximity of his manor house on Mill Hill, were absentee landlords and more concerned in the context of trade depressions with profits than the well-being of the residents. Vignettes like this view looking along Infirmary Street to the commercial buildings, which we'll touch on shortly, do provide a visual clue of the genteel Georgian estate, but they are rare. In 1805, the year before the Park Square residents saved their green space, freehold building plots were offered for sale in the area bounded by Park Row, the two parades, and Infirmary Street. Progress was, however, initially slow, and the buildings that first emerged were initially public buildings. Situated at the junction of Park Row with Infirmary Street, the courthouse was the replacement building for the Moot Hall in Briggate, which we touched on last time. In 1809, a rate was levied by the corporation for the express purpose of funding this. And in 1813, the new building, designed by architect Thomas Taylor, was ready for business. The main courtroom could seat 800 people. It had 13 cells for short-stay prisoners, and the basement had space for four fire engines, as up to 1861, it served as a fire station, with the police sharing joint duties. In 1834, a first floor was added, and this was designed by Richard Dennis Chantrell. The entrance was a large portico with Corinthian pillars, supporting the roof, flanked by single-storey wings decorated with codestone panels depicting the Golden Fleece of Leeds, which was later part of the Leeds coat of arms. In its later years, and after the opening of Leeds Town Hall in 1858, it became a post office, before it outserved that use, and a new post office was built on City Square. A near neighbour of the courthouse, and also following a neoclassical style, the Philosophical Hall came to the west side of Park Row in 1821, on a site which in 2020 is occupied by HSBC. Its purpose was to house the activities of the town's newly formed Philosophical and Literary Society, and it was the precursor of the modern Leeds City Museum. And in addition to housing an amphitheatre, it also had galleries for displaying museum collections such as natural sciences and archaeology, among other things. Built by R.D. Chantrell in a restrained Greek Revival style, it was a fitting location for a middle-class organisation dominated by the professional and mercantile classes that lived close by. With its entrance, later moved to Park Row, initially on what we call Bond Street today, it was surrounded by a fine iron palisade. While the original Georgian building, much remodelled, succumbed to bomb damage in 1941, a Victorian extension remained to the 1960s, and as the City Museum, it's still very much remembered by many. While not directly impinging on this area of land, one last noteworthy addition to the area in the Georgian era was this grand affair, the so-called commercial buildings, built at the junction of Park Row with Bourne Lane for the expanding needs of the business community by John Clark, who won a competition to build it in 1825. Its Ionic columns rose to 40 feet high and were 4 feet in diameter, and the foundation stone was laid by Lepton Dobson on the 18th of May 1826, and it opened in 1829. Here are two photographs, definitely taken before 1871 when it started to be pulled down. It served as a rendezvous point for the commercial men of the town and contained a newsroom and several other meeting and reading rooms. We are fortunate enough to have the engraved trowel used to put into place the foundation stone, as well as this view of its interior, which clearly shows the newsroom. The addition of the commercial buildings to the mixed cloth hall and courthouse made for a sort of city square before city square. But the rapid pace of change meant, even by the turn of last century, this made for nostalgic vignette, which features the mixed cloth hall to the left, the courthouse slightly further up, and the commercial buildings to your right, all gone by the end of the 19th century, with the Leeds District Bank, built in the 1830s, on the far right. There is a sense that the close of the Georgian era marked the close of a particular sort of experiment in this part of town, for by the 1830s, the well-heeled residents of the Park Estate were fleeing for the suburbs. This may have been on the cards even before that decade, when the land between South Parade, East Parade and Park Row was finally infilled, because since 1792 there was, not far from the Park Estate, the presence of Benjamin Gott's Park Mill, later Beaning Mill, a huge woolen factory where the Yorkshire Post building stood till fairly recently. And this cast a shadow over the residential development. Smoke from steam engines and gasworks, and also the dye works at Droney Lathe, started to blow across on the prevailing winds and irritated the residents to such an extent that there were two attempts to prosecute the chimney owners for smoke nuisance in 1811 and 1824, both unsuccessful. Nor did the area, in spite of early intentions, escape the encroachments of industry. A gasworks was built in Park Street in 1824, and the last of the Leeds squares were built by the end of the 1830s. These were Hanover Square in 1828, Woodhouse Square in 1829, and Blenheim Square in 1830. The so-called respectable citizens that lived in these parts sought accommodation increasingly elsewhere, such as Chapel Allerton, with its elegant and appropriate designs for villas and fancy cottages, according to the Leeds Mercury in 1825. And one well-heeled individual who made a move like this was Darnton Lupton, who had once lived alongside his warehouse and workshops in North Street. In evidence to the Select Committee on Smoke Prevention in 1845, he said, "Everyone who can is going out of town." Note the can. And in the 1830s, omnibus routes were developing to places like Headingley. A new trend was emerging. So I'd like to close this presentation by saying thanks for listening. And if you've enjoyed listening to this, there are plenty of great sources and books on the subject out there that aren't in the museum collections. I've personally found Alan Godfrey's reprinted Ordnance Survey Map series, the 1847 series, one valuable source, and referred heavily to it in the slides. And for the text, Maurice Beresford's East End, West End, though now over 30 years old, is still available to buy online and remains very useful. And just to say, always consult your local library. Leodis.net is a fantastic source for historic pictures, as many of these buildings survived the age of the camera, though some only just. Thanks for tuning in.